go bird watching or you go to a park? And he said, if there's a rare bird, I go bird watching, otherwise I go to a park. And that is Cotton Leader Mahesh. He studied agricultural science at the University of Agricultural Sciences, Dharwad. There he took this special interest in insects and in rearing insects. He joined the entomology division of the Indian Agricultural Research Institute in Pusa, New Delhi in 1996 for his MSc, where he integrated work in biochemistry, molecular biology, and entomology, and he briefly looked at birds. He then went on to start his PhD in entomology, but he dropped it partly. Instead, he joined the Indian Air Force Short Service Commission as an air traffic controller. He was posted across the country, mostly near the borders, north and northeast India. When he was posted in the cold, high altitudes of Leh, he did a very unique experiment with local berries. He was preparing cocktails, and this novel experiment won him a lot of acclaim from higher officers. There also he found some time to do birding and all that. But then it was the home posting in Yelahanka where he began to bring together his knowledge on practical aspects of runway management, statistical techniques, bird ecology, and behavior to produce a study on birds and their management in the Yelahanka Air Base. This work was done beyond the call of duty, and the Indian Air Force took his report very seriously. In fact, they extended his service by promoting him to the position of Deputy Director at the Directorate of Aerospace Safety in the Indian Air Force. He has traveled across India and he has conducted studies on bird hazards in airports and has also tried different management techniques. So after retiring in 2010, he started his own company, which now offers a product for bird dispersal through the playback of carefully tailored calls. And he also does part-time work in organic agriculture industry. And he's done a lot of bird illustrations as spectrographics that are available on Wikipedia, and one of them you can see on screen right now. So to throw more light on bird management at airports today, I welcome Mahesh Iyer.
Well, I have forgotten about the cocktails. Anyway, when we used to jump off the aircraft at 3,000 feet, from A72, we used to pray to parachute Mataji, Ijai, and then jump off, believing that the parachutes will open. Not, you know, disbelieving the person who has packed the parachutes in a particular manner so that it should open properly. I think the days have come today when you are boarding your flight from any of the airports from India, in India, you need to pray to Bird Mataji, to not hit your aircraft before it takes off. Such is the pathetic condition we are living in today. And authorities are also not taking this issue very seriously. Over to this topic with this preamble. There are two milestones, 1911 and 1932. I won't bother you with much of the details. 1911, many of the things happened, but you might even pass out the history for one small incident, like, you know, from Allahabad to Naini, 26 kilometers, first civil flight took off and landed at Naini, landed or returned back to Allahabad, over time Naini. And in 1932, Imperial Indian Air Force was founded. Between 1911 to 1966, nothing happened. When I say nothing happened, I am always talking in the perspective of bird management. So in terms of bird management, nothing happened in our airports. If you look at European countries, America, other places, they have meticulously collected bird data. But in India, we are not even bothered to collect data. We are not even bothered to know which birds are striking our aircraft. We don't know our enemies. If you don't know your enemies, how can you design your tactics? So, in 1966, when Salim Ramji was facing the corridors of North Block in Delhi, trying to draw attention of the bureaucrats to give some funding for economic ornithology. Like the way in form of blood, it could be a mangled whole bird sometimes, or a few feathers. It could be a big feather or a downy feather. So in fact, I would rather like to put it that way. Indian Air Force started sending the bird feather samples to BNHS for identification. Robert Grubb went to Smithsonian Institute and then started, he learned the identification of macroforensic identification techniques, and then he started identifying the birds that are hitting our aircraft. I would like to call 1966 as the beginning of, I have coined the term aviation ornithology. Don't search in Google, you don't get that. So that is the beginning of aviation ornithology in India. And then, for the luck of Salim Ali, in 1971, ARDB was formed. First of the bird studies which took place in India was sponsored by ARDB. Many of us might be knowing about this. I was in the Indian Air Force, I tried to get many of the reports from ARDB, I could not get. I tried getting the bird strike samples from BNHS. It seems that BNHS also did not have the bird strike samples analyzed from 1966 to when I joined Ornithology 7 Air Force. That is in 2007. We don't have any data. So they funded the first study. That was done in two phases. You look at the picture. This is the cover page of all the 22 airports study had the same cover, except changing the title. It was conducted in phase 1 and phase 2. Phase 1, Agra and Ambala airports were studied by Dr. Salim Ali himself along with Robert Grubb, and he established certain techniques as to how field studies should be done, which remains kind of a standard even today, but with little variation here and there. And then looking at the success of the first studies, in 1982, 20 airports more were studied. In these 20, some of them were civil airports also, and majority of them were Indian Air Force airports, or we call them as air bases. So they submitted the reports in these things, and now look at one of the pages extracted from the report. BNHS recommended removal of trees and planting of blue grass. In Hindi it is called blue grass, or for the scientific community you can call it as Sinodon and Dactylon, which is very common in our area. What happened? You can see this. All the trees, large and small, growing within the aerodrome should be removed. All sugaring, cultivation, all that. This is the extract from Gwalior report, but of course, this is the summary of all 22 reports report. Many airports, I don't know about the civil airports, many airport stations, they got bumper opportunities. I was witness to that. In many of the airport stations, we had beautiful forests, which were all cut, mercilessly cut. The breadth of the trees were measured and it was cut. IFS officers, Air Force officers, civil bureaucrats, all were there. And then I was wondering, what is happening in our airports? Why are they cutting the trees? That's when the things started rolling in my mind. And coincidentally, in the 1990s, when BNHS studies was concluded, vultures were the main culprits for bird strikes. I think you might be knowing about it. And many of the vultures were also shot in many of the airport stations and even in civil airports, I don't know. And carcass used to be the main problem in those days outside the airports, many of the airports used to be outside of the cities and then used to be next to the villages, so a lot of carcasses used to be found. And vultures always used to be. Vultures were the culprit, but coincidentally, when I cut the trees, vultures also started declining. 99% of the vulture population crashed. It's like, you know, I cut the trees, birds are also, bird problem is also going away. It's something kind of a coincidence. But removal of the trees created a lot of open spaces in the airports, which attracted kites. And none of them realized these birds never sat on the trees, either for resting, roosting, within the airport premises. But by then, we had lost many of the old trees with a lot of endemic birds in those airports by then. And then some of the airports tried even planting bluegrass without even realizing what grasses are growing in their airfield, whether bluegrass is suitable for their soil type or not, even the weather. Sirsa in Haryana, Hindon in Delhi, even our Yelahanka airport tried planting bluegrass, all of them failed. And post these studies, Indian Air Force got permission from the Ministry of Environment and Forest, those days it was MOEF, not NCC today, selective shooting of birds was permitted. And I'll come on this topic, dwell on this topic even more in the coming slides. I call the period from 1990 to 2005 is the decline of airport bird studies. There were four pillars of bird management. Everybody was into those four pillars. And in 1990, ISRO also launched a GSLV project. We also launched the GSLV project. We stuck to this. ISRO progressed. What we did, we only did garbage management, carcass management, we shot the birds. We tried to level the lands, and we tried to manage the vegetation. But that was not sufficient for us to control the manage the birds in the And then now, civil airport versus defense airports, what happened was, many of these civil airport people tried to give graphical serviceability of graphical flight safety, which means their airport is fine and safe, but bird flights still keep happening. What they do is, in civil airports, you have Indigo, SpiceJet, and so many airliners operate. And suppose if I'm an Indigo airliner, I get 5 bird strikes this year, and SpiceJet does not get any bird strikes this year. So there won't be any complaint from SpiceJet this year. And Indigo is crying. And the airport which I'm servicing, I will say, okay, the bird strikes have happened, but not in my airport. It's in the destination airport it has happened, not in the departure airport. And the destination airport says, no, bird strike has not happened in my airport. It must have happened in the departure airport. So they kept on tossing the responsibility between the airports, and the bird data was not collected, and real effort in managing the birds never happened in those days. And in the meanwhile, Indian Air Force got into VNHS for a second project in 2006, which unfortunately VNHS could not complete. And within a year, it was scrapped. So the questions which were not asked were these. Was it prudent to remove all the native trees, vegetation inside the airport without even bothering whether they are really using those vegetation or not? Was it prudent to replace indigenous grasses with loom and maintain short grass tank without even bothering which birds are coming into your airport? Sorry. You look at the map here. This belongs to Goa Airport, Dabolim International Airport, where grasses have been mapped by me. If you look at this map, and these are all the numbers of the grasses, okay? And grass number 2 is some species, grass number 7 is some species, 10 is some other species. With this, what happens is, you know what native grasses are growing in your airport, which are all attracting birds in the form of insects or in the form of grains, and then how can you control that or manage them? With this, you can manage, spot management can be done. 70% of your manpower requirement can be reduced. Insecticide can be reduced. And you can go for removal of certain species of grasses rather than blanket removal and replacing it with dhoop grass. That was not done. Many of these birds never ventured into the runway. They were all in forest areas, in the airports. But in the name of flight safety, most of them were eliminated. but was it prudent? How about the attraction factor of the birds to the airports? Why are they coming to the airports? Have you ever bothered whether they are coming for the food? Are they coming for roosting? Are they using your airport for resting? Or is it migratory behavior? We never bother. To give an example, let's say kites. Kites in Bangalore, everybody says, bury the garbage, remove the garbage. But in Bangalore, kites might be coming for garbage. But in Jodhpur, kites may be coming for thermals. In some other airport, they may be even using the airport for roosting. You need to understand why these birds are attracted to your airport. If you are not understanding why they are coming to your airport and simply trying to target garbage management, it will not give you solutions. That was not done. You look at this. This is called the risk analysis table. On the left side, you have the probability of damage to the aircraft if the bird strikes. On the x-axis, you have the probability of strike by the birds. It has got different colored cells. This is high risk, this is medium risk, and this is green. Green color is low risk. And many of the species won't even fit into this table. If they are not fitting into this table, they are not even risky to your flying. So you don't have to bother about, you don't have to spend money on these those birds. You can only concentrate on these high-risk birds. That was not done. So in 2007, we established ornithology cell in air quarters with the aim of not to cut the trees and not to kill the birds. And that was very difficult. We studied about 33 airports. And by the way, do you know, we lose about 3,000 crores per annum just on the bird strikes in India. I am not talking about the intangible cost. Intangible cost is the engine is withdrawn and it is lying for repair. The original equipment manufacturer sends the blade and then you put it, do the aero test, ground test, and then you put it into the aircraft. Aircraft flies and does the air check, and then it comes back, and then you detach the engine, okay, for shipping it to the original base where it came from. It takes 6 months. It takes 6 months to service the engine. But in civil parlance, if an engine is not flying for 6 months, how much of revenue it must have lost? Have you calculated that? That was not calculated. These are all intangible costs. I'm just telling you the cost of the base, servicing, and flying cost to 3,000 crore rupees per annum. We could able to reduce 47%, which was equivalent to 1,000 crores per annum. We could able to train hundreds of bird watchers. I am proud to say many of them are better than me today. They are very serious bird watchers. So with this introduction, I would like to discuss two case studies with you as to how we can manage the birds in airports without cutting the trees and without killing them. I would like to call them as parakeets of Gwalior. Anybody has been to Gwalior? Okay. There is a place called Hazira. If you go there are around 200 trees. In the evening, by this time, if you are walking in that area, you have to carry an umbrella. Literally, more than a lakh rose-winged parakeets congregate there every day, every evening. You can't sip a cup of tea under the tree.
You get masala tea, sir.
They fire shots in the day before the bridegroom ties the nuptial knot to the bride. You know, it's such a menace there. But they are there for more than hundreds of years. This side is Gwalior city. This photograph is taken from the north, facing towards south. And Gwalior is also one of the premier places where we have Mirage 2000 aircraft. Anything, do you know anything about Mirage 2000? That was the aircraft which made us happy
study. Number 1, number 7, number 8.
Okay, that's the squadron master. I'm talking about the aircraft which helped us to win Kargil War. Because of Mirage 2000 only, we were able to win the Kargil War. So only one aero station is the entire country which hosts Mirage 2000. So these Mirage 2000s were constantly being hit by Roslin parakeets. And Roslin parakeets, as you are aware, they are flock farming birds. They fly in flocks. Okay? And in our day, we used to have common strikes, multiple strikes by Roslin parakeets every year in Gwalior. Look at the engine plates. Turbojet engines have got four stages, five stages. First, next time you are, you know, climbing in the ramp of Indigo or SpiceJet, you just try to look at the engine, which is slowly rotating. The first blade, if you see, this is the first stage of the engine. Like that, there are four or five stages inside the big engine. All of them are rotating independently. Okay? When the bird goes, hits the first stage, goes to the second one, third one, and fourth one, maybe even fifth one, and comes out also. You never know. But damaging all of the stages. Now, when the bird damages the engine plates, it happens like this. You see the vent here? You won't be able to fly the aircraft again. Why? It may not be having the same lifting capacity.
What is the impact force?
Sorry?
What is the impact force for an ordinary parakeet?
That's what, see, Subhi, this is kinetic energy transforming into kind of a potential energy. 1 kg bird, the impact is something like 1000 kg hammer. You bung a brick, to the aircraft, nothing happens. But you have one ton hammer and try to pound an aircraft, something really happens there. Okay? I think you also might have heard air hostesses always telling oxygen ki naka girega, all that, right? If the bird strikes the glass in front of the perfect glass in front of the pilot at a certain altitude, the air pressure will be, you know, totally, you lose, the aircraft is pressurized at a higher altitude. And the whole pressure goes away. All the dissolved nitrogen, other gases in the cell gets, you know, there's a mechanism called effervescence, Coca-Cola. When you open the bottle, there is a fist. Something like that happens also inside your cell at the higher altitude if the pressure is not maintained. So you have to immediately inhale the oxygen. That's only possible when the bird strikes. So that's the impact. So with the parakeets, we used to withdraw a lot of engines. And Mirage engine serviceability used to, you know, escalate. Cost of that used to escalate. And BHS had already studied Gwalior. Unfortunately, they have not even mentioned Hazira in their report. And they acknowledged there is a problem in Gwalior. They strongly recommended to cut the trees. And Gwalior had a very beautiful forest south of the airport. I'm going to come to that. But Gwalior people did not cut the trees. For whatever reasons, they did not cut the trees. And the problem continued. This is Hazira, Gwalior city. Northeast of the city is the airport. There was a single runway those days. This is the forested area with accommodation and all that. And very old fruity trees. If you go there, you feel like you are entering the forest. On the north, this area also belongs to Gwalior Air Force Station, which had scrub forest. When I say scrub forest, mostly dead palm trees and then bare trees and bare shrubs and things like that. Okay. And we positioned ourselves en route and counted around 6,000 parakeets every day. Out of 1 lakh parakeets, 6,000 used to visit Gwalior Air Force Station. Of course, this number keeps on varying depending on the seasonality, what kind of fruits will be available here. So, I'm just telling approximately when I studied in the month of July, 6,000 parakeets used to visit airport. Now, they come and settle on these trees, south of runway. If they had settled on the trees south of runway, and if they are not crossing them to the north, there was no problem. It was a win-win situation for us. But problem was, when we did time series data all along the runway, we could find parakeets were passing along these paths, about 6 different paths. And in Warrior, runway 24, this is 24, is being used for the movements. This is where the aircraft lines up, takes off. This runway, opposite runway, is used only for 1 month. Why this particular runway is used? Because of the winds. You get winds in this direction. So aircraft always flies into the wind. So 11 months, they used to use this runway. And we found parakeets are crossing like this. And we found that these are all the percentages of parakeets crossing the runway and going here for feeding on different plants. And there was one fruit grove very far off the airport station, and 34% of the parakeets used to go in that direction. The megalus is taken off like this, and this is where they unstick themselves from the runway, and this 24% of the parakeets which are crossing over here, let's say 100 meters to 200 meters, form the conflict zone with the height of the aircraft coinciding. So Mirages also used to attain 200 meters here, and parakeets are also crossing at 100 to 200 meters. But obviously there was a conflict zone. There was no conflict zone here, all other places. Only here the conflict zone was identified. Now you see, 76% of the population of the parakeets are not problematic in Gwalior. Only 24% of the parakeet population, below 6,000, have become problematic at this particular point. Now what did we do? We went and studied what's happened here. We found in this skull, maybe a lakhs of parakeets used to come and roost. You should visit North India, I think you'll get a different perspective about the birds, the roosting, their congregation, their numbers, it is sheer, unbelievable, not found in South India. So, lakhs of house sparrows used to come and roost there. At least 1,000 P4s used to come and roost here. They used to roost on the guns. They used to roost on the lampposts. They have denuded the big palm trees. The fronds have fallen off, and they used to sit on the big palm trunk. Every big palm trunk had one P4 in the evening. And okay, I forgot to mention about some of the fibrous trees were also growing in our side of the runway. In the conflict zone where we are interested in. Yes, sorry. This area I'm talking about, around 32 bell shrubs were there, and some ficus trees, very big ficus trees were also there. That's where these parakeets were always going. Hundreds, I said thousand, yeah. Hundreds of house sparrows, hundreds of P4s used to start in the north. And the peculiarity was, the P4s very rarely used to cross the runway to the south. And house sparrows also never crossed the runway to the south. Because they were operating north, they used to go to the farmer's field, because south they were sitting and suburbs, so they never used to come to the south of the runway for foraging. They used to go to the north. And they used to roost in the north of the area. So this is the analysis of the situation. So if I had suggested the flight safety functionaries in Gwalior to bulldoze the scrub land in the north, instead of solving one problem, I would have invited two problems. Because P4s would have shifted to the trees in the south and roosting, would have roosted, and then used to cross runway everywhere to reach out their foraging grounds in the morning. Similarly, house sparrows also would do the same thing. So what did was very simple. Agriculture students would know in crop physiology they will be taught, if you remove one branch of the tree during the flowering season, the tree diverts most of its energy to produce leaves. I don't know how many of you know this. So what I did was, I wanted the flexibility functionaries to selectively remove those 32 bare shrubs, they were not trees, and not to bulldoze the entire area. Plus, these 5 ficus trees, in the month of January, I wanted them to cut one branch. Now, I am supposed to report to Air Marshal in the Air Headquarters. Being a squadron leader, I was supposed to report to Air Marshal who is next to Air Chief Marshal. Okay? And how will I say cutting one branch of the tree would help solving your problem? So what we did was we did a thorough brainstorming. I think Shaman was not there with that in the brainstorming. So we invented the term canopy engineering. So I went to the air marshal and said, sir, problem can be solved by doing canopy engineering. What is this? Who are the experts in the country who can do canopy engineering? I said, I can do that. Okay, you suggest the canopy engineering. Today, if you go and ask anybody in Air Force, canopy engineering is practiced. But trees are not cut. Okay? So, canopy engineering was suggested, and selective removal of bare trees were suggested. And then I went again to Bollywood to see how this has taken effect. Almost around 22% of the parakeets have shifted towards grove, along with this existing 34%, and another 8% went into this area. Still some of them crossed, but significant reduction in the number, you can see. These are all based on the time series data. So the conflict zone which was here, either you know, shifted at these two places, where mirages will be on the ground, or less than the height of the parakeets here, and mirages will be above the parakeets at this place. Now, today if you go to Gwalior, parakeets are also flying, mirages are also flying. This is Mirage. Now I will come to the second case study. Have you ever seen greater charcoal marks? They are sparrowhawk birds, and I call them as marks of weather. Beaver has got two numbers. Again, on the Air Force Station. I was in Bareilly doing my studies, and this is how they come in the winter months. And you will literally run into the wall of great shadow glass. Jamnagar, you can't fly in the winter months. They come in, you have to go there and see the sheer number of the birds there. Such is the number of birds. So, larks infested with the radio station. They sat on the runway. They flew low over the runway, 2 meters height, 10 meters height. They don't fly very high, larks. Beaver, in 2008, when I studied, I think that article was published in Indian Birds. Hawks were newly introduced in Beaver Echo Station, and when they started flying, training flying is also important in armed forces. One flight used to take off, 10-15 birds used to be inside the engine. The aircraft will abort the flying, abort the takeoff, and then when you remove the engine, you find a lot of birds inside, and some of the blades are bent. And as I told you, 6 months for repairing of the engine. Okay. Have you ever used the Reynolds pen when it was introduced? Long ago? You were kids. Before that, all the refins used to fit all the pens. But when Reynolds film came, only Reynolds film used 52 Reynolds film. Similarly, in aircraft, if blade number 32 is bent, you can't take out blade number 32 from similar engine for the same aircraft and fit it into that. You have to write to original equipment manufacturer sitting in France or Russia or in England to die cast blade number 32 or engine number so and so, so that he will charge you a hefty amount and then sends you a blade and you fit it into your engine here. So such is the cost involved. Training flight was cancelled for 1 month and I was studying birds in Bareilly. One aircraft, I got a call from Director General, Air Marshal, that evening, one arrow was sent to Bareilly. I was airlifted from Bareilly and I was in Bidar the same night. One aircraft was sent to me to lift from Bareilly to Bidar. I landed luckily when rocks were not flying. So, to tell you how grasses are important, how the grass height is also important, is this case study. Just before my before the arrival of the logs, as a routine maintenance, they had cut the grass. Just after the monsoon, they had cut the grass to 15 centimeters. You see, logs in a half-heighted grass. And when the logs came in thousands, they were afraid. So flight safety functionaries are always under some responsibility they have, and they have to answer to various higher-ups, and then they have to ensure the safety of the aircraft. And when you have multiple injections taking place, training flying is cancelled, the pressure is mounting. So what did they do? They cut some more grass and made it into short. They started shooting. How can you shoot small birds? If it is a big bird, you can kill and beat and kill. But small birds, you just fly, you can shoot it into the air and you might kill one. But they are there. And they started beating drums also along the sides of the runway. Nothing was working. So here at Water Intervene, look at the runway. This is one runway and this is another runway. You can see it in Google Maps. I had developed a unique technique for counting the birds and also placing them on the ground. Like say for example, if you spot a bird, you have to fix it onto the ground location so that you can study where the abundance is more. I think Sham will help me in correcting this technology. Anyway. So when I get this time series data with geotagging of the number of the birds for both the runways, I'm just giving an example for this runway here. You see, this entire thing is, you convert it into a kind of a grid. Zero is on the runway, given a highest priority on the horizontal planning, south and north. This is the undershoot, left, right, center, sorry, left, center, right, should have been, and then takeoff area. So it's an arbitrary demarcation on the runway, but it really helped us to capture how these greater short-road logs are operating in Bidar Airport. And this was the area which had long grass, but when the sheer number of the short-road logs came, in the panic, they cut this also. So this entire runway shoulder had become short grass area. When I counted the numbers in the flocks using counting methods, you see all these bold numbers? This is where the most of the logs were concentrated. Similarly for this runway also. So if you see the analysis of the entire report, the logs operated in Bidar Airport in a corridor manner, in a corridor fashion. The corridor lay entirely over the short grass area, not in the long grass area. You know why birds avoid long grass area, smaller birds? They avoid long grass because they always want to have some kind of a visibility when they are foraging. A harrier might come and pick them for eating. If there is no visibility, they can't fly away in time. So most of the birds, when they are foraging anyway, even in airports, they have to have good visibility unless otherwise they won't venture into the restricted areas. If there is a tall grass, if it is taller than the bird's height, they will not go. They avoid that area. So they were clearly avoiding long grass areas in Bidar, but that was established using time series technique. This is how they were operating. And that's how they have became menaced to the flying efforts there. This area is sort of a field where this is declared as some black buck sanctuary, and it had a tank also. And black bucks used to graze the grass here, and always the grass here was short. This is where the great shorter larks roosted in the night. And that area was not under the control of Air Force. Whereas this area was belonging to Air Force, and this area was also belonging to Air Force. So what I did was, I divided the entire area, this entire corridor, into three zones, blocks rather. Block one with short grass, block two, again with majority of the short grass. This dark green is long grass, light green is short grass, but this also became short grass. Okay? And this area was again having short grass because the arts of sheep and goat, people used to bring the herd of goats and sheep and they used to forage there. So what I did was, I wanted to fragment the habitat so that it should become less attractive to greater shorter larks. We recommended, don't work, don't exert yourself in cutting the grass. In the post-monsoon season, you please don't cut the grass. That was very good suggestion for them because you know, it saved their manpower, petrol, diesel, tractor and serviceability, all the headache gone. So they welcome this idea. So don't cut the grass. Only in the month of February, March, you cut the grass to reduce the fire incidents. See, therefore what happens is, sometimes they fire a very pistol. Have you heard a very pistol? In the olden days, when aircraft controlling was not there, they used to fire flares, colored flares. Have you seen Titanic movie?
Yes.
They fire flares. So if you fire a green flare, clear the land. If you fire a red flare, not clear the land. And in Chennai, one of the Saudi aircraft landed, jumbo jet landed in Air Force station. They fired a series of red cartridges. Airport unsafe, do not land. That is the language of the aircraft control. But the pilot was sleeping and he still landed in Sambaram Airport. So when you fire flares for communicating to the aircraft, in the modern days, the flares don't have any purpose, but we still use flares to disperse birds. Okay? But kites do get attracted to flares. Anyway, that's a different story. So when they fire flares to disperse birds, some of the flares, if you don't fire in a proper angle, they come down burning and the grasses catch fire. And the moment the grass catches fire, you find hundreds of barn swallows, swifts and kites and other birds which are, who are interested in eating the flushing insects. So in order to prevent the fire hazard, we recommended cut the grass in the month of February, March. That's when the larks will go back. And here, we ordered, because this is the approach path for one of the runways, how do you fragment this area? You grow Proserpis. Proserpis julithora. Of course, it's not a native species, but I have to go for them because Proserpis julithora will not grow into a tall height, number one. Number two, the birds and sheep will not let the Proserpis grow tall. But it will definitely fragment the grass area, which will disturb the short-tailed larks. And along the main road to the airport, I asked them to grow bougainvillea so that it looks good. And another thing is, if the rainfall pattern is also important here. In the all these rocks come from Gujarat to south, and then till Hyderabad they come, and they don't come further down. So if there is less rainfall in Gujarat area, some of the airports are in Gujarat, if you monitor the rainfall pattern in those airports, and if the rainfall pattern is, if the rainfall is below average, and weather receives above average, definitely the logs are going to come to the area. If the rainfall is good there, you may get less number of logs to your area. There is a correlation we found out. So that was suggested. So that in case if the rainfall is less in Gujarat area, if you receive a normal or above normal rainfall here, be prepared. Be prepared for great shortfall logs. And they are shooting carriers, not the aircraft, but the birds. So we told them don't kill the harriers. See, raptors, they are less in number in an airport, but they get used to the aircraft movement. Raptors do get used to the aircraft movement. If you remove the birds, like raptors, the gap is filled. Very soon, the vacuum is going to be filled. But the newcomer would not be used to the aircraft movement. The chances of bird strike will be high. So we told don't kill the harriers for the present season. And we also recommended use of indigenous glow sticks, which helped them tide over the present season. But in the coming months, when I interacted with the weather flight safety functionaries, they have forgotten their shortfall logs. They have not forgotten that. Because of the fragmentation and growing of the log grass, the whole entire continuum is broken. I think that's all. Any questions?
Is Indian Air Force audiology cell or NHS maintaining feather atlas like the US Fish and Wildlife has been maintaining feather atlas of birds?
No. Indian Air Force, definitely no. DNSS, I really don't know what happens there. We do get the feather analysis by DNSS. Offline, Indian Air Force, I wanted Indian Air Force also to start analyzing, you know, the bird blood, which is found on the aircraft. Almost around 30-40% of the strikes are in the form of blood. Blood smear, just a blood smear. So we became the sixth Air Force in the world to embrace mitochondrial DNA cytochrome oxidase 1 investigation technology, barcoding, and then analyzing the species, identifying the species. I think Lacon in Hyderabad is doing the service for Indian Air Force. So we now don't need any data, including bird feathers, plus the blood smear. We do analyze and get the data. But we don't maintain any of the bird feathers of that sort. Yeah, please.
I might be missing something. So when I walk into a flock of, say, pigeons, they all just fly away. We learn at the 10-meter distance.
Walk into the flock of?
Pigeons, as an example. They all fly away. On field, if you have a running engine of an airplane or a jet, the engine sound is really, really loud. That should be enough to, like, scare the whole flock away.
Yeah, see, engine noise is also called as a white noise. It doesn't have any meaning to the bird. I have seen red band lapwings, yellow band lapwings on the edges of the runway. In our run, I have seen IL-76 and IL-78 nowadays with four turbojet engines, full throttle on the line of point, and this fellow is sticking to the ground, not even leaving the nest. Not even leaving the nest. And if you go behind the aircraft, you will take multiple somersaults and end up somewhere 200 meters away from the aircraft. Such is the way turbulence. Such is the white noise. But they don't seem to get scared. They get used to the high decibel level in the airports, and they don't. It doesn't have any signal to them. I think I have to take reference of Mendix India. Another interesting fact that one something was in Indian Railways also, when the engine, the train goes at, let's say, 60 kilometers per hour, but if it goes 100 kilometers per hour, even pigeons can't escape. See, the reaction time for a bird to see approaching aircraft, which is, you know, B-21 slam at 270 kilometers per hour. And aircraft do fly at 1000 kilometers per hour. We human beings can't cross the road if somebody is coming at 40 kilometers per hour, maybe 60 kilometers per hour. So when the aircraft is coming at 1,000 kilometers per hour, or 300 kilometers per hour, what cannot be
seen? Do these points really make a difference? Are they ever considered? Just to understand as a noise.
Such level of studies are not happening in India. It's not happening. It is highly desired, but you know, nobody has time and means to do that.
Air Force Station Alanka was very much worried about the Mawalipura garbage dump.
Yeah.
Did it have any effect on the funnel of the?
Yes, yes. It had, and see, on the papers, most of the government projects look very good, but implementation matters. They say, I have attended many of the meetings, so also you. And as per the Aircraft Act 1934, you can't have any garbage collection or dumping within 10 nautical miles of the aerodrome reference point. Having said that, Mawalipura was falling well within that zone, and then any airport would have defined airspace in terms that there are very highly technically defined airspaces. Even if you want to build a building, you have to get a special permission from the airport authorities to keep your building height at a certain height. And these approach funnels and approach areas and airport spaces are sacrosanct, and nobody can violate that. And Mawalipura is one of that. The civil authorities were trying to sell it off to Air Force authorities, saying that we will see that no garbage will spill. Can anybody believe that? Hundreds of trucks going and no garbage spilling? And they say that, you know, we will do it on German model and things like that, but it is hard to believe and in India at least. Frequency modulation is something like audible frequency is 20 hertz to 20,000 hertz. Above 20,000 hertz is ultrasonic surface. Below 20 hertz is infrasonic. When I'm speaking to you, I'm modulating my speech, which means there is a frequency modulation. Frequency modulation always happens, but only thing is that you need to communicate to the animals in their own language. If you don't tell them this area is dangerous, they would always venture, whether you modulate your frequency or not. Frequency modulation is an entirely different concept, and communicating is another concept. Yes, for your answer, I would say yes. For your question, sir. Yeah.
Which airport are you looking at next to solve?
I have just completed the Goa International Airport. We would be doing Visakhapatnam and Gorakhpur.
Since you mentioned Visakhapatnam, there was a recent report about rainwater, because of the rains, the shallow areas around the airport were flooded, and all the wetland birds came.
It happens in many airports.
Oh, okay.
It happens in most of the airports. Seasonal pools of the rainwater attracts lots of birds in North India. Hmm. But in Vizag, I have not yet started the studies.
Okay.
So, it would be interesting to observe, because it's on the sea coast, definitely.
I can vouch for what he said. Just outside the takeoff point, is the wall, after that is the road, and just after the other side of the highway is totally wetlands.
Okay.
All shrubs of this height. I've seen that.
But it was a Herculean task to convince the authorities not to shoot the birds, because when you shoot the birds, they say, okay, in front of me, I'm killing this bird, it is no more there. But it's very difficult to fill it into their heads that the moment you kill the bird, within a day or two, the vacuum is going to be filled. I think Subhi also has got the same experience with many of the authorities. So it's very difficult to remove certain notions which are ingrained in their, you know, head. Such was the oddity, against which I fought in the autocracy system. being a junior level officer, maybe with some kind of a success, whatever. Yeah, please.
So from whatever you've explained in the two case studies we saw, there doesn't seem to be one solution fitting everything.
Yeah.
Each one is a customized one.
Yes.
So are there any, so what happens mostly is post-mortem, or if some airport contacts you, or you come to know and you do something. So then it effectively is post-mortem, but do you have any suggestions where proactively something can be done, if at all it exists, for people who want to listen?
May not be possible.
They may not see the country.
See, all these activities can be classified into short, medium, and long term. And short term measures can be immediately implemented. But you know, in this field, I also have to submit one incident. I have a friend called Albert D. Kuhn, who works for NATO. He studied Kabul Airport. Not only Kabul, Bagram, Mazar-e-Sharif, and all these airports in Afghanistan. He flew Apache helicopter, he did bird survey in Apache helicopter, and he sent his report to me for just like a see how I have done. And he has suggested remove the lake. Kabul Airport has got one big lake on the Amishore, like just like in Guwahati, where many of you might have seen. One square kilometer big lake. He simply said in one sentence, remove the lake. Many of these people who suggest the measures for bird management, unfortunately even in India, they don't try to fit their feet into the shoes of safety functionaries. That's why most of the modules, they don't get implemented. And another thing is, after this copy-paste thing has come, I have even read, he has mentioned, cut the grass in Bagram Airport to manage the birds in Mazar-e-Sharif Airport. And I googled, I thought this is a hi-fi funda, must be. Then I thought, okay, they must be co-located in airports. Then I googled it, they are 150-200 kilometers away. Then I typed all that, why are you cutting grass in Bagram Airport or controlling birds in Mazar-e-Sharif Airport? Then he says, oh, sorry, so the cutting paste. And he mentioned my name as an acknowledgement section on this report.
Understands and is sensitive to the fact that this needs to be controlled this way. I'm asking more from the corporate scenario succession planning and what happens after you exit. Sorry.
I think short of your answer, I don't know.
So there's some documentation, some training, something.
See, the beauty is I am coming from air traffic control background. Okay? I know how aircraft are flown, what type of aircraft is flown, what is the type of exercise they do, having military background also. So this adds into the plus point, which is that I'm also observing birds. So little bit into statistics also. All these has produced a combination in me, which is, you know, I try to fit my feet into the shoes of flight safety functions. That's all the difference I'm doing, nothing else. So I think for any bird watcher or any bird management expert should learn these things before, because you know, most of these experts, they say, okay, crows build nest in this season, they use these number of sticks, and they build nest at this height, and the eggs, these many eggs, and then one egg will weigh this much. He will explain it to flight safety functionary, and flight safety functionary will say, wow, but tell me sir, these crows are problematic in my airport. At that point, most of these people fail. They see crows are sitting on trees, cut the trees. They see crows are sitting on garbage, remove the garbage. Fine, you must do some of them, not like, you know, blanketly applying your observation into action. You need to really study and understand. They don't, most of them don't have the idea of how aircrafts are flown. What are the rules that are bound? See, if you don't know the rules, you can't suggest a measure that would really help the flight safety function. That's what I can say.
So
this is a
combination of
their concerns.
Yeah.
So now in Bizarre, there's 9 aircraft formation going on right now, and they have a problem with geese. How do you say that?
Problem is?
With geese.
Geese.
There's some geese. Barred geese.
Barred geese.
Barred geese.
Bird and geese.
Causing problem for the
beaver has got a lot of wetlands.
For the Niagara formation is a bit
some of the same, you know, for many of the birds you may not be able to design models. When I go to the airport, out of 40 high risk birds, I might be able to crack for let's say 5 to 10. The rest of the 10-15 still will be problematic. That needs a longer study. Yeah, beaver has that aquatic bird problem. They not only have these geese but also ducks. This is between ducks, yeah.
Because we then
in the rainy season lots of shallow pools happen and many of these birds patronize these. And they fly north south just crossing the runway at lower height. Yes, sir.
You mentioned about bioacoustics being used on the airfields. What bird calls do you play?
See, many of the birds don't sing at all. For example, egrets. Kites produce two calls in their entire life, two or three calls. And the passerines have got a lot of complexities in their singing mechanism. Some of them produce 3,600 repertoires. Some of them are even infinite. So, some of the birds can be dispersed using some of the bird calls, generic. Some birds, like pigeons, they have dialects. I can't drive away an authentic pigeon using the distress call of South Indian pigeon. So, given the complexities of this kind, even if you have, let's say, 20, 30 calls of different birds, on an average, I think about 60 species can be written as on date in India.
Let me add to my sister. Mine is where I speaks in one of my classes. I offer agricultural anthology. I took him and we played the cards. Then suddenly all the dogs in the area came and come around. All the dogs in the area came with us. It was a distress call of a dying bird. And they said that there's some food available.
Actually, the whole sky was blackened by crows in GKVK campus. I was overwhelmed to see so many number of crows. See the amount of damage they might be doing to small birds here.
Yes. All the birds are managed for the migratory birds in the air.
Like in India, we don't manage any of these migratory birds. Yes, in foreign countries, they do have bird radars. Bird radars, around 30, 32 bird radars were supposed to be brought into India and were supposed to be used in Indian Navy and Indian Air Force. But unfortunately, that has been stagnant for so many years, almost a decade, I think. I was the one who initiated it and came to see the light. But migrating birds, we just hear sometimes, at higher altitudes. Most of the bird strikes happen below 1,000 when the aircraft is landing. Or when it is taking off. The rest of the 10% happens outside the airport when the aircraft is cruising height, but that's very rare. No studies.
Yeah. What's the thoughts on the few places where falcons are used for flying the birds?
We tried that also in Indian Air Force. Unfortunately, Ministry of Environment and Forest asked us to get a report from SECOM. Without which they didn't want to go ahead. And Air Force and SECOM got into a kind of a deadlock system where in which Air Force wanted to reduce the price by some ways, which SECOM did not agree. And somehow MOEF was convinced that, okay, we are not going to use any of the falcons available in India, we are going to import it from Middle East. And then cost of maintaining falcon is also very high, I don't know. So, if the falcons, let's say 100 gram of the falcon is the correct fighting weight, if it becomes 110 gram, it will become lethargic. If it becomes 90 gram, your automatically investment will go away. Okay. Such is the complexity. The art of falconry is not easy, number one. Number two, there is always trust between the falconer and the falcon. Falconer will trust the falcon to come back. And falcon will trust the falconer to give the kill which has killed, not steal from him. Okay? There are a lot of other complexities also. Maintaining falcon is not that easy.
And they have to pay the falconer also.
Yeah?
Perspective.
Yeah, there are a lot of other methods, waterfall, there are one last question.
So with respect to the previous question, with regard to the American Airlines AT-20, which landed the Hudson, that was nowhere in the vicinity of the airport. How could you control borders at near that altitude?
That's very difficult. Canada, he struck the both engines of that aircraft, and he landed in Hudson River, rescued all
is
the
there passengers. A measure of...
It was just after the takeoff. See, airport authorities have got their own area. They have full authority on the area. They can do whatever they want. But problem is, nowadays, interaction with the civil authorities. HAL airport is the most deadliest airport in India as on today, as far as the birds are concerned. Because if you are interested in flying in and out of HAL airport, you must be really taking a mala and then it's that. Because the interaction with the airport authorities and the civil authorities have always been some kind of a, it's a bane in our India, that nothing moves. In Agra, 30 years, they wrote letters to civil authorities for the same reason of birds. There was a huge, the meat producing industry, okay, which was just within the reaches of Agra airport. They wrote 30 years letters, tons of letters. At last it was removed. Why? Because three-star hotel came and foreigners used to come there. Immediately civil authorities removed that, meat producing unit. Otherwise, it was not supposed to be removed. Such is the status of our HAL airport has written 25 years, AEMC meetings, 25 years they have written letters to the civic authorities. No garbage is removed. I don't know, we are in a state of bliss. We don't want to do anything.
If I can intervene here, I just remind Mahesh of some incident which happened. Mahesh was preparing to take bird watchers for observation into air bases. He had got the approval, he wrote to me, I put the thing on PNG birds, one, and he put only two conditions. One was that it should be an Indian national. Two, he should be an adult, he or she should be an adult, not a child. Not anybody below 18 or 21 years, I don't remember. And he told me that only one kid responded. Is there on PNG birds archives? He had taken the permission.
You remember a year ago?
No.
I was not alive.
Okay, I think.
Thank you so much.
So, please accept this.
Thank you.